Good evening, everyone. My name's Cherie McNair. I'm the director of the Australian Centre for Photography, and thank you all for joining us tonight for exposure series number 5. We're looking at collecting tonight, but firstly, I'd like to acknowledge the Gadigal of the Eora Nation, the traditional custodians of this land, and pay respects to the elders, both past and present. So, welcome tonight. We're joined by Judy and Annear and Amanda Love. And for those of you that have booked in, you've probably seen quite a significant introduction to these two people that have been fantastic in joining us and giving us their time. So Judy is an independent writer and curator and was senior curator of the Art Gallery of New South Wales from late 1995 until mid-2016. In this role, she instigated a program of collection-based projects as well as curating major national and international exhibitions, including Len Lai, Man Ray, Bill Henson, August Sander, Alfred Stieglitz, and several thematic and group exhibitions. We're also joined by Amanda Love. Amanda is a passionate collector and has a substantial private collection, in addition to her role as founder and director of Love Art, an international art agency based in Sydney and New York. Through Love Art, she provides bespoke, confidential and independent art advice and has pioneered contemporary art collecting initiatives in private, corporate and public realms here and internationally. So thank you both for joining us this evening. So just to start, can either of you recall your first acquisition, and do you still own the work?
I can remember mine, of a photograph. I can remember it very clearly. It was Bill Henson's Paris Opera series. Must have been in about 1992, and I'd been collecting painting for, you know, artworks for a number of years. Having graduated from my master's in fine arts at Sydney University a few years before, and I walked into Rosalind Oxley's gallery where she had pinned up on the wall the Paris Opera series and was just absolutely bowled over by them. But I said, they're fabulous, but they're, you know, I don't collect photography, I collect art. And we had a robust discussion from which I walked away quite beginning to understand that how photography could come to be art, and we took things from there.
Right, and Judy, I suppose for you it's a slightly different proposition in a big institution. There's lots of forms and paperwork and acquisition reports that have to come through.
Yes, I couldn't develop a private collection of photography because if you work in a public institution, it's a conflict of interest. So I do remember the very first artwork I bought, which was from a friend of mine when we were both students, but it wasn't photography. So, in fact, my personal collection is extremely small, largely because I've always worked in the public arena and therefore it's not possible to cut across that. So, but at the Art Gallery of New South Wales, I had to raise all the funds for acquisitions. So it was a bit slow to start with, developing a budget to buy. And everything I bought for the Art Gallery of New South Wales was had to fit into the policy that was developed and approved by the executive. So, so it's, you know, it's a sort of complex set of checks and balances which I could elaborate on ad infinitum for you, but maybe not right now.
Well, I suppose we can go into the sort of the private versus the needs of institutional collecting. So, Amanda, you talk about quite a personal response to work that you were interested in, and then you had a discussion about collecting.
I still own,
coffee.
By the way.
Fantastic. whereas the institutional needs and the policies and processes are quite different, but is there the same response, I suppose, in terms of the immediate response to work versus the research and the proposal that has to go with it? Can you talk about some of your own experiences in relation to pulling that together and the different needs of the two different types of collecting?
Well, I think they're, depending on what type of a personal collection is being developed, I think they're very different, Judy. I mean, it seems that a personal collection is just that. I mean, you have, and I think that's the beauty of a personal collection. I think some of the best personal collections are collections that have collected works that speak to the collector at the time, but then last, and as a body of work, speak for them and for a long time in the future. And in that sense, they become a portrait of the collector. And I think that's the benefit and beauty of a personal collection versus the encyclopedic and studied nature of an institutional collection.
Yes, I do agree. I really love going to people's homes, actually, and seeing their personal collections and what they've acquired. It's a great luxury for me to see, and I also mean that in terms of historical collections, regardless of the medium, actually. It's always very, very interesting to see what people choose, and I don't have an opinion about whether people make the right choices or not. I don't judge in that sense. I'm just very interested to see what people respond to, how they look after them in their home, and I always feel it's a great privilege to see that in situ, because it's much more intimate, of course. Whereas at a public institution, you're working to a policy, you're working to a particular kind of budget, which of course a personal collection you do too, but also you're thinking about heritage, you're thinking about posterity, you're thinking about trying to be representative, even though the biggest budget in the world is not going to make any collection truly representative. It's just not possible.
So in terms of both of your aspects of collecting, how important is the research element? So for people that are looking to start their own collections, how do you suggest that they go about it? Is it an immediate emotional response to the process of buying a work, or is it a research-driven activity, or is there a combination of the two?
Well, I think it's a combination of the two. I think research is vitally important, and that's a particular value of institutional collections. I think research is vitally important because the more of something that you see, the more of something that you know and understand, the more you understand your own reaction to it. So if you've just seen one photograph or one film, you might know that you like that, but you won't have an understanding of whether it's a good film in the face of all the films having been produced. And I think as a private collector, you only have the obligation to buy what moves you, what you like. But I think, why not choose that from what's objectively worthwhile you're paying attention to, which is something that which would have a life beyond just your acquisition of it in terms of historically.
Yes, I agree. I think you need to educate yourselves, and that's what I would do if I was building my own collection. It's really a matter of, you know, if you're interested, and there's many, many niches in photography. I mean, one of the things that's sort of thrown at as an insult at photography is that it's very diversity. But to me, that's one of its great joys, and it's also something where an individual can carve out a niche. If they like press photography, then there's endless possibilities for acquiring vintage press photographs. You know, Australian historical photography is wide open in terms of the possibility of putting together a very interesting niche collection. In places like America or Europe, this kind of thing happens all the time. Or you look at, you know, contemporary photography. But you need to pick a thing that you really love and drill into it and do the research, and your horizons start to expand, and slowly over time your eye and your collection becomes more and more refined.
And you take a journey as well. That's, you know, as a collector, you then take a journey with what you learn and what you're experiencing and what you acquire and what you look at and relate to today changes what you will find engaging tomorrow.
Mm. I suppose where, in terms of recommendations for where you get this information, is it at a time where, you know, we've had the announcement this week that Still's Gallery is closing, that you're now faced with the potential of entering the unknown world of commercial galleries if you're starting collecting for the first time? Do you spend more time at commercial galleries? Do you spend more time at the Art Gallery of New South Wales? Do you...
Instagram.
Yeah.
I'm joking. I'm just saying that because we're going to talk about that.
Well, Instagram is one place, but there's a broad field, again, of possibilities. I mean, everything from photography magazines to, you know, some of the major museums of the world, like Metropolitan in New York, despite its current problems, has the most phenomenal website emanating from its photography and conservation departments. The Art Gallery of New South Wales has a sort of small, you know, it has information online. So does the State Library of New South Wales. There's many, many ways that you can get information informally through magazines, art books in libraries, going to galleries, you know, hanging out at the back of auctions. That's a really interesting thing to become interested in if you have nerves of steel, which
it's only for the intrepid.
There's one tonight. Rob Gould's collection's up tonight. So I suppose it's seeing... Do you find it interesting what other people have in their collection? So,
just talking about buying art at auction, I mean, I think that is very much for the intrepid. Buying photography at auction.
Yes.
I mean, Judy, I think... I mean, photography is like wine in this sense. If you don't know exactly how it's been stored, where it's how it's been purchased, and you don't know everything about it, I mean, do you buy much at auction? I mean, contemporary photography?
It was very difficult at the Art Gallery to buy things at auction, and we only ever bought a few historical things. But and I personally have only ever been to one auction, and that was it. I decided I was never going to go again.
It is pretty shocking.
It is pretty shocking because, you know, they just bang through it. And you do have to know exactly what it is you're looking at, which means you have to see it outside of its frame and you have to have a conservation report and. So it's complicated. And then you have to have nerves of steel if you really are going to bid for it.
Or, I mean, nowadays, often I would buy a work of auction if I knew that the artist was someone, was one of those artists that would reprint it, you know, for a fee, which sometimes... You can do that, but then you run the risk of not having the paper and you get into a lot of that argument.
Mm. Yeah.
So I suppose on that, when you talk about the process of requesting a reprint from an artist and from artists that work in that, photography has the benefit of being able to produce multiples. And I suppose we've seen it to a certain extent with the exhibition that we have on here with Under the Sun. The iconic image of Max Dupain is still available to be printed today. When you're acquiring photography, do you look for something? Do you look for the first print out of the series? Do you look for the artist proof, so a one-off out of an artist's collection? Is there anything in particular, or is it okay to buy edition number 15 out of 17?
It depends on the process. And, I mean, editioning really only for photography really, really only became... thing to do probably in the 1970s, 1980s. And of course that's borrowed from printmaking, and it's a way of controlling what is available on the market. It's very straight up and down in that regard, whereas in printmaking, I mean, if you're looking at a lithograph or something, then it's really important what number it is in the edition. With digital printing, it's, you know, it's really just about how many are there. Because technology is changing so rapidly, my view over the 20 years I was at the Art Gallery was that I started to treat each print as being unique, and it had to be, you had to look after it accordingly, because you couldn't guarantee that you could get anything that looked like what you had originally acquired. So, and the technology is moving, it's constantly moving. As Amanda mentioned, the papers keep changing. It's very complex. So if you buy something, you have to understand that you have to look after it, which of course you want to, if regardless of whatever that thing is. my view is, unless you really are just going to buy posters or things for $50 or $100, then and understand that it's maybe not going to last very long, you do want to look after it.
But that's the kind of the conflict with photography in particular, because the conflict about collecting a work and then buying a work that because you want to enjoy it, and I mean it's unresolvable in a way, because theoretically, if you're buying a photograph, you should buy it and put it in a vault or in a cold, dark room and never see it. And so the minute you're putting it on display, in a way, you're compromising the integrity of the work. I mean, albeit, there are ways of mitigating that, or making it as little as possible by how it's framed, how your house is covered in, if you have the windows covered in solar tint. I mean, I'd advise anybody who has any kind of art to have all their windows covered in, it's not very expensive, in solar tint. The way, whether you rest works, whether you cover them up when you go away, whether you rotate them, there are all sorts of ways of mitigating it, but you're never going to maintain a photograph that you display perfectly.
Mm. Well, it's the same for everything. It's just that, I mean, everything does wear out, if you like, eventually. It's just that some things are much slower than other things, and pigments change, and it's just that some things are more secure, if you like. But it's just that works on paper, whether they're photographs or, watercolours or whatever they are inherently fragile. So it's there's certain things you need to do, really. To museums are at a particular end point of extreme end point of care, because they do have to look after things for forever, if possible. So you just need to be wise about it, I think.
I suppose, Amanda, with your collection, do you store your photographs in Solander boxes when they're not on display?
I'm traumatised by my photographs. Honestly, I really am. I mean, I love photography, and I've engaged with it for a long time. I mean, over 20 years. But it traumatises me. I mean, conservation of it traumatises me. The editioning and terminology, which you have to come to terms with and understand, which changes internationally, it changes across time, it changes as people get more used to dealing with photography. And I'm traumatized by framing it. I mean, it's often photographs seem inexpensive and easy to ship, be shipped flat-packed, but when do you then come to framing them? And how you frame them and maintaining the frame. I mean, I think it's traumatic. I mean, when I bought Something More, for instance, I mean, I saw it at the MCA, I think probably in a collection that you probably curated, Judy. I think it wasn't Wits End, and it wasn't Photography is Dead, Long Live. It was before that. It was just, I think it was printed in 1989, that photograph. Unbelievable to think that it's almost 20 years old. 20 years old? 30 years old.
Yeah.
Almost 30 years old. But I'd seen it at the MCA. I didn't know about Tracy. I just was completely galvanised by it. Read up about her, found out where her gallery was, which was Stephen Morry at the time. Like possibly, I can say the slackest gallerist, can I? Anyway, and it was just there. Like he just unrolled it from the back of the room. He sort of got it framed by Charles Hewitt. I didn't even know it. We didn't even ask. Talk about conservative frame, whatever, paid for the frame. He brought it round to my house in the back of his, in the boot of his car. And we just sort of propped it up against a wall. But, I mean, that work was, it was just a photograph. It wasn't a Cibachrome. There were no additions at that time. They hadn't additioned, because no one knew about additioning. Tracy was making the work as and when somebody, I must have been the third person to come along and ask for one. It's all changed since then. But it's Charles Hewitt framed it. I subsequently found out that he didn't know anything about conservation, archival framing. I mean, there was a bit of cardboard stuck to the back, and the frame bent initially in what's his name's car. Anyway, it's a very important work, which I've subsequently resolved about how it is framed and how it is printed and how it is editioned, and it's all sorted. But it's a traumatic process if you don't know what you're doing.
And do you think that advice is readily available to people? So to get access to information about conservation and storage and exposure periods of time, do you think that information is available?
I think it's glossed over in the sale if you don't know what you're doing and you're not advised.
Yes, you do. You do have to think about it and hunt for the information. It's true. Most photographers or artists or whoever's working with photography, they're not going to be able to. They may not be able to afford to print off an edition of 10 or 20 and have them matted and framed or framed or whatever. That's an expensive proposition. So people did print purely to order. You just have to be very careful about what you're doing.
And then there's terminology like differences where, whether it's an edition of one with edition of, how many with X artist prints, or whether like Simran often works in series, so, it's a unique work but part of a series. There's all kinds of nuances that you have to come to terms with, I think, if you're going to collect photography in seriously.
When you look at someone like William Yang that started to write a lot more about his own collection and about his own photographs and occasionally on the photographs, because that's all information that's in his head, would you recommend the people that are collecting do that themselves? So keep
write
a diary
on the photographs?
About, not necessarily write on the photographs, but write the information that they have about that photograph, where they bought it, stories that they hear about it, sort of keeping the kind of history of the work with the work?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's really important. That's what public institutions do. They build artist files, and it's not just the invoice and the payment details. It's everything about that artist. It's everything about that work. You record when something comes into a collection. You record. You make sure that you have a record of everything to do with that particular object, front and back, and you just build up the information. If you have time, and this used to be a norm, but largely these days it just isn't the time to do it. But interviews with artists, and if it's a private collection, having some kind of contact with the artist, and certainly having contact with the dealer in order to know more about that artist and what they do and how they do it, is really important. I can't emphasize that enough.
And Amanda, have you done that? Have you met most of the artists that are in your collection?
I don't actively seek out to meet an artist of a work we acquire. I don't acquire works because I have lots of artists who are friends, but I don't acquire works because artists are friends. I acquire the work solely on the way the work speaks to me and the merits of it and how it fits into my collection. But as it happened over the years, I do know most of the artists now who've made work whose work we've collected. I don't assiduously take diary notes about their practice because I rely on Judy and her institution to do that.
Right. I suppose talking about collections for people that are starting to collect.
But I do keep a comprehensive catalogue. And do keep a lot of information about the provenance and what's happened to the work and, right. And where it's been exhibited and all that sort of thing.
How do you group your art together? So, we've talked about the sort of process of encyclopedic collecting that institutions often have. When you go to look to acquire a new work to the collection, do you have a sort of a mental note of what you've already got? Do you take things with you so you're looking to fill a gap in terms of the process of building your collection?
I never, ever want to acquire an art. I go out hoping that I would never see something that makes me want to buy it. That's why I think I'm not really a collector. I've never gone out to buy a work of art. So I really do go out hoping that I will not find anything that compels me to go through that process of, one, paying the money and having to acquire it, because I'm a kind of minimalist, so I don't really need or want a lot of objects around me. But I'm obviously the art gives me an enormous pleasure, and it's what I do, the way I see the world and what I do 24 hours a day, one way or another. But so I don't go out looking for something to fit in. I go out, and if I'm galvanized by something, I work out whether it will or it won't. And even if it won't, and I think I'm, you know, I can't stop thinking about it, then I just make it. Which is a good way of, I mean, you have to justify it and work out how it's going to fit in, which is means you can sort of juggle all sorts of other things around.
Whereas with a public collection, well, the way I did it, I mean, every curator in an art museum probably has a different approach. And if you looked at the photography collections, say at the NGV, the National Gallery in Canberra, Queensland Art Gallery, Art Gallery of South Australia and Art Gallery of New South Wales, of course they're all different from each other. And there's practical reasons for that and historical reasons. And then the approach of each curator and director. Because, of course, a curator isn't some sort of lone wolf that just does it all by themselves. They are subjected to whatever the director and the trustees think is appropriate. So, you know, the curator can propose policies and collecting areas, but that doesn't stop the director and the other senior staff from, you know, wanting to do certain kinds of things. But because my budget was always very small, there are a number of decisions I made when I first went to the art gallery that I pretty much stuck with, actually. I mean, some curators do look at public collections and they think, you know, this is an enormous hole, and they set about to fill it. Whereas when I went to the art gallery, I looked at the 19th century material, which at the Art Gallery of New South Wales was regrettably almost non-existent, and I decided not to fill that hole. And in fact, I did very little about it until I started researching the photograph in Australia. Gail Newton at the National Gallery in Canberra built a superb 19th century collection of photography for the National Gallery. The State Library of New South Wales has an encyclopedic collection of 19th century Australian photography. It's brilliant. So I felt I could step away from the 19th century, even though it pained me greatly, mm-hmm. that I couldn't do anything about it. And so I decided to play to the collection's strengths, which was contemporary Australian photography from the late 70s till now. And even so, I had to be extremely selective just simply because of the budget, and build some small groups of international photography. And I built a small group of European modernist photography because I think that's an extremely important area for contemporary practice. And I looked at international photography from the region, so New Zealand, Japan, and the United States. So I didn't follow fashion, and basically that's how I proceeded when I could raise the money to pursue those things.
Do you think there's still an appetite for collecting photography, or, and at the other extreme end, that it's still within reasonable collecting reach for people starting out?
Definitely. If you look at the statistics, I think something like 80% of photographs on the secondary market sell for under $5,000. Might even be 86%, something like that.
And Australian photography, whether historical or contemporary, is very reasonably priced. If you look into European or American photography, even Korean photography, you'll find the market is quite is pretty good for contemporary work. And, you know, exponential, in fact, in terms of some people like, what's his name?
Well, Tracy's peer would be Gursky, Struth and Roof. So her peers internationally are those guys. And if you look at their works, which are selling from 400,000 US to
over a
2 million at the secondary market.
Yeah.
And Tracy's, you know, you can buy works from something more. Series, not the first one, for $35,000.
Was in the big auction of Max Dupain photographs, was it last year or the year before? You know, you could get a good experimental, one of his experimental works from the 1930s for, well, it depended. I mean, the prices were all over the place. Anywhere between 10 and 50,000 Australian. Whereas if you wanted to buy a vintage Man Ray or another major name of European modernist photography, you'd be looking at 250,000, if not a lot more. So, you know, it varies from country to country and, you know, the historical period or contemporary area that you're looking at. But it's very... it's very easy to build a good collection of photography from all over the place. Japanese post-war photography, for example, is extremely reasonable. And, it, you know, it just so happens that the local market in Japan is not as strong as the Korean market. So, you know, it varies quite wildly. But Australian photography is underpriced. That's my view.
I've advised over the years a very important international collector who first came to Australia because he thought, came to look at Australian photography because he'd seen Max Dupain's works internationally and he said, I thought he was French. And he came and he just couldn't believe the prices of Max Dupain's works, you know, maybe like 15 years ago, but they haven't really moved that much. Compared to, again, his peers, like Man Ray, I suppose, or, you know, internationally.
Exactly.
And in terms of keeping track of the market, where do you recommend that people go to look for that information? Because when you're involved in the industry, the art industry, you come about it through conversations with colleagues, through kind of journal subscriptions. Where would you recommend people go for sources of inspiration of where to go to shop for art and photography, but also to know whether or not they're paying more than what they should for a particular work?
Well, all the auction records now are catalogued. I mean, the difference between the art world now or of the last 10 years in the art world 20 years ago is the financialization of it, and art is now an asset class, theoretically, thanks to sites like artprice.com and, well, the Mimosa's Index, and where you can just go online and get the entire auction career or of most artists, and they're, you know, ranked from 1 to 500 according to that set of values. But that doesn't mean you know about the conservation. You know, you might know the price of a photograph, but you don't know anything about the photograph that you're looking at, probably.
This is why it's really good to start building artist files because, you know, when I go to shows and I was always assiduous in collecting those room sheets with the price lists. And so, you know, I've kept them all, basically.
Oh, we do too. We have a 20-year archive. Which we keep as an archive.
So, you know, you just, it's really just about educating yourself. There's a zillion databases, very good ones like ArtPrice and that Amanda mentioned, and there's an amazing amount. You know, most public libraries, at least big public libraries or the gallery library has access to databases that people can use. So there's all sorts of ways and means of finding out and keeping yourself on
top. But you're right, that's secondary market information. Primary market information, if you haven't been to the shows and you don't have the room sheets and you haven't kept that information, That's very hard to find out.
Yes.
I have a 20-year database of all of that information. It's amazing to go back now and research it, be able to research an artist and sort of get that 20-year history.
I suppose for people that are starting out on their collecting path who may not have huge amounts of money to spend or perhaps want to look for something unusual, we've talked about a lot of fairly significant Australian artists tonight. What about some of the smaller artist-run spaces? Have you, either of you, taken a chance on someone completely unknown and new?
Yep. And in fact, the last 4 or 5 years I was at the gallery, although I always bought young, mid-career, older artists, we really focused on young photographers, young artists. And we built, we expanded that part of the collection. So that's something that I spent a lot of time on before I left. I felt there was a kind of broadening of interest amongst younger artists, whether it was through zines, not that I was buying zines, but I was very aware that there were younger photographers who were making their own books and zines, and there was a great expansion of practice. People were starting to look at old, film, using film again, making cyanotypes. The field just seemed to broaden quite dramatically, and I felt it was really important that the art gallery was able to reflect that.
Oh, I agree. I mean, I think collecting art and looking at art and being involved with art is always a dynamic, and the more you know about history, the more you find what's being done today relevant and interesting, and vice versa. In terms of young photographers, I mean, you only have to look at the exhibition Under the Sun that you've commissioned mainly new work for. From be 50% very young artists. I think there's a lot happening at the moment, actually, in terms of young Australian photographers, young Australian art generally, but photographers in particular.
Yeah, I think it's really rich. I mean, there's Sarah Oscar, Christopher Day, Zoe Krogan, is she 30? I'm not even sure if she is. She's got a solo show at the NGV in Melbourne. It's either just about to open, I think. There's a great deal going on, and I think it's really important. I mean, the ACP had a wonderful show, their second to last show at their old premises in Oxford Street. What was it called, Claire? The Alchemist, yes. So, and one of my final shows at the Art Gallery was New Matter, which came out of all the work that we did. And there's been a whole number of shows going on around the country dealing with this, and workshops and activities of one sort or another. And I think it's really important to keep track of. I mean, a lot of the commercial galleries in Sydney are showing people working in this way, and so there's a real interest in it. It's deserved. I mean, these young artists are doing really interesting work.
I think it's interesting at the moment or now how increasingly photography is not just about the photograph. It's often incorporated into a project or as one part of a project. In terms of Judy, just being collecting photography for the museum, how did you incorporate artists' work in a photography collection that was actually in an expanded practice? What did you do?
I just used to sort of, push my way. I just used to say, well, we're doing this basically. But I guess that's one of the fabulous things about photography. It's from its inception, it's always refused to be pinned down.
Mm.
And it's always possible for photography to be constantly reinvented. And there have been periods in the history of photography where, fashion has taken over and for one reason or another. Whereas I think what's really great about what's been happening from the 90s till now is that it, you know, this broad field, it's all travelling together, regardless of whether somebody is, you know, seen as a black and white photographer or someone who works with a diverse range of media. I would try and not buy anything where the primary practice wasn't photography. I mean, a lot of people use photography, but if it was someone who was known really for installations, I wasn't going to buy a photograph they did, by and large. I mean, it just, you know, the contemporary department had a much bigger budget than I did. And so I would draw lines. And
so would you buy Richard Prince, for instance?
Prince came in through the Cold War collection, so I was happy for that.
Yep. All right, Ai Weiwei's Han Dynasty. Diptych.
No, probably not, because he does, I think of him primarily as an installation artist, I guess.
Yeah.
But also I was very sort of hard-nosed about this because my budget was so small. I mean, I was only able to raise like $50,000-$60,000 a year, so it doesn't go very far.
I suppose one of the things that we talked about earlier, Amanda, is this proliferation of images and through Instagram, and bigger institutions internationally like Tate are starting to, or have had for quite some time, time-based media departments where they're trying to actively collect the digital. Have either of you kind of expanded into collecting the digital image, still digital images?
Well, I mean, I have, and I've put together collections for private and public institutions and private people of time-based media. When I was in Berlin in the European summer, it was very interesting because the Julia Stotchek collection of time-based media had just opened as a pop-up in Berlin and was causing a lot of commotion. It was a brilliant collection. It had people like Ian Cheng, Ed Atkins, John Raffman, a lot of sort of some virtual reality pieces, a lot of and that was really garnering a lot of attention. In terms of, do you mean normal, in terms of just video art?
Random,
I mean, I collect video art is something else. I mean, houses now are made for video moving image art. Most houses have at least 5 screens if you count the computers, televisions, intercom, in flat screens, and they're always black if you're not using them. So having a digital collection is the perfect way to utilize these platforms and engage with a world which is definitely an important part of the contemporary world. The moving image is prolific. I mean, it has also, digital art is transportable. You don't have to, it's easy to store, theoretically. And it's not that expensive. But again, there are a whole set of problems and a whole set of conservation issues and a whole set of worrying about what kind of platform will digital images eventually end up on, that you have to consider when you're putting together moving image art or time-based art.
Yes, it's, you know, there's been interesting discussions over the years about, you know, do you store each technological change, as in the platform, so that hopefully you can go back and revamp technologically and store whatever it is so that you can keep it going in perpetuity. There's a very interesting case that's of an installation that's been on at the Museum of Modern Art over the last 6 months, a Japanese artist called Teiji Furuhashi, and it was his final work that he made in 1995. And it had to be completely rebuilt because slide carousels were an integral part of that work. And it took his colleagues in Japan and the Conservation Department at the Museum of Modern Art in New York an enormous amount of time and energy to figure it out, because it wasn't just the slide carousels. The Museum of Modern Art in New York has published on its website an essay from their Conservation Department that indicates the process they had to go through to do this. And I know it's something that was really exercising the Conservation Department at the Art Gallery of New South Wales. Any video material that was made on pneumatic or on tape, basically, it...
Can't play it anymore.
You can't play it anymore. If you can, then it's faded. Data, so people who were doing computer art in the 80s and early 90s... there's a kind of entropy that sets in to the data. But at the same time, I'm completely fascinated by people who are using Instagram as a platform for their art. And I was spending a lot of time thinking at the art gallery how to encompass this. Because apart from still photography, I was buying a little bit of video work, and I overlapped with the contemporary department in that regard. But I was thinking very carefully about how to encompass image, heavy work that was appearing on Instagram made by artists. I didn't get to the end of that story, but somebody is going to have to at some point.
A challenge for everybody. It's a good way of keeping track of up-and-coming artists.
It's a brilliant way of keeping track and learning. In one sense, you just hashtag an artist, you've instantly got everybody's opinion or a number of... If there's nothing there, well, then you can ask yourself different questions. But if you can get endless opinions of what that artist has made, what people think of it, how it figures, it's in the press of a button. On that level, it's incredible.
What do you think the challenges are for a new collector sort of starting out in this world of Instagram, multiples, historic photographs? Where would you recommend that people start?
Research. Research to find out what it is that moves you, and how... I think at the bottom level, art is a way to engage with the world. And so... And that's the beauty of it. And it takes you into the world, and it takes you back into history, whatever you're collecting. So research what it is that you like the look of, and then the feel of, and then you find endlessly fascinating, and go with that. It doesn't really matter whether it's historical or what it is, as long as it speaks to you and you can afford it and store it and conserve it and frame it and worry about it.
Yes, I agree completely. It's now that I'm an independent curator and writer, my budget's even smaller. So I am very focused on very young artists at the moment. But at the same time, I'm keeping an eye on everybody I know as well. But I think for somebody just starting out, you have to have that personal engagement with what it is that you're going to bring into your home. It's got to be there. It's got to be something that you want to have around you, even if you're not going to look at it all the time. And then you really need to learn about it, because that will take you, your curiosity, in all sorts of directions that you may not have thought of. And, that's the pleasure of actually acquiring these things. You start following objects and people, and your horizons keep expanding into the world of the imaginary, pretty much, one way or another.
Absolutely. And what did she say? One thing personally I would advise is, I think wherever you start, it should be And whatever level, whatever historical level or whatever financial level or whatever level of confrontation or engagement, it's usually the things that have just pushed me that little bit beyond what I'm ready for or what I can understand or what I can immediately understand and take in or come to terms with and sometimes even afford. Those are the things that if I've just managed to push myself and then acquire those things, they're the things that are long-lasting and that take you somewhere else, where if there's something which is just immediate to you, often that doesn't last and it's not really where you want to go. And often it's the things that are kind of the most disconcerting and sometimes irritating that you can't get out of your mind, that you don't instantly engage with, but you engage with after time, that they're the things that are lasting as well. I can remember, say, going back to Tracy Moffat as an example, getting involved, buying something more, buying a number of works from that series, coming to terms with her practice, and then couldn't wait to go down to see the next the next series of works that she had. And I think it was Scarred for Life in the international section of the Venice Biennale. And I raced it. I couldn't wait to see what she was doing. And I was like, oh, I've got the wrong artist. What is this? You know, it was just so different because that was what her practice is always about, doing something different. But that work, I couldn't stop thinking about it. And after about a year, just, you know, had to acquire it.
How are we going for time, Anthony? Yep. So we'll open up to have questions from the floor. If anyone, while we've got these two people that can help you along your collecting journey, or even questions about their own collections, if they're happy to answer them. And this.
Sorry, we are recording, so if you can wait for the mic.
You didn't answer the question regarding editioning, like which is important, number one or number 15. Some people say number 15 is because that's the last one ever going to be produced, etc. And the other problem I have with work is artists don't sign the work. And to me, that's important because you could go along to a gallery with a 100 megapixel digital camera and basically reproduce it or photograph it, work on it, and you know, pass it off as a forgery. And I've had lots of problems with galleries, even major galleries. They said it's unsigned. I said, where's the edition number? Oh, it's not on the work, etc. Oh, we'll give you a certificate of authenticity. I'm saying, great, you're going to give me a bit of paper and there's nothing on the work. Nothing matches up. So that is a problem with a lot of galleries who just don't understand. I had this problem with a gallery in Melbourne and they wanted to give me, a certificate of authenticity, etc. And, you know, you can't even prove the work is by artist XYZ or what the title is, what the edition number is. It's, to me, a big problem. So just comments in how important is editioning and, you know, just accepting my comment is people, photographers don't sign work.
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, it's vital, and I think it's a can of worms that hasn't been addressed over the last 20 years. It's in particular, because it's been such, in terms of contemporary photography, because it's been such a nascent and dynamic form. I mean, I think it's very important that if you can, you have the work signed. You definitely should have the work editioned. And you have, as Judy said, all the documentation you can possibly get about the work. I think that in terms of what to acquire, and Judy will answer, we've had lots of conversations about this over the years in terms of which edition is better than another. I mean, Judy's right about it not being so important with photography as prints, but I think the general rule is the closer to the original, the edition that you get, the better, you know, the smaller the number. But that then depends on what's available, because if an edition is sold out and there's only the last one available, well, then you definitely want to take that last one and you're damn glad you've got it. And then, you know, artist proofs go after that. Or do artist proofs... It often depends on what you can get.
Yes, I agree. I agree with everything Amanda said, basically. So you just have to be totally firm with, if you're going to buy something, if you want to spend money, then you want exactly what you want. But in terms of editioning photographs, it's, you know, I can only repeat what Amanda said, actually. I think it's, and I, as the Art Gallery of New South Wales could often move quite slowly, and dealers are not going to wait. So you basically take what you can get in the end, within certain parameters. But it never bothered me that much whether it was edition number one or edition number 15.
You think it's more important when you're looking at estates and archives? So the Rennie Ellis Archive is still producing work, for example. We've got Max Chapin's archive being reproduced. Do you think things like editioned numbers are more important if you're looking at works that are created posthumously that are non-vintage prints?
Well, are they? Do they? They're not editioned though. The posthumous prints, are they? Of Dupin?
They keep track of numbers, but you might be buying the 200th or the 2000th. The Rennie Ellis Archive do number them.
Then you would be paying. I would imagine that you would pay according to the fact that it's posthumous and. The number might be unlimited, or it might be, you know, whatever it is. You wouldn't be paying the amount that you might pay for a vintage.
Oh, that's right. A
signed live print.
I had an interesting case recently, though, which I'll put to you guys, where I had some German collectors who were very, you know, had experienced collectors, and we were looking at Bill Henson's works, and they actually requested the APs when other editioned works were available and less expensive. The APs are generally more because they're generally sold, if at all, after the editions been exhausted. And I found that surprising.
Yeah, some collectors really like having the AP. To me, it's a little academic, but nonetheless, some collectors specialise in APs. That's what they want. They don't want anything else.
Mm.
Sorry, Judy. I'm just asked. It's Margot from the State Library. Hi. With the artist proofs, because we have just acquired the Max Dupain archive, so of course we have many different iterations of many different. Of the images in his collections. And we do have artist proofs within that swathe now. What advantage do you see in an artist proof? Is there more value to an artist proof beyond like the next stage where this is the cropping, the exact interpretation that they want for the final edition? Do you think there's any extra pizzazz with the artist proof per se?
But did he sign them AP?
No, not at all.
So they're posthumous?
No, he would have done them at the time, because you can see they're rougher. You know, the paper's not trimmed, and you can see that on the page that it's been a test per se for another edition. Perhaps.
So who has designated these works AP?
I am just assuming, because they are not like the other works that we have of his that are more, you know, ready for market type prints. These are much more dark room. Maybe it's a test print, perhaps, rather than an artist print proof.
Yeah, I mean, I would tend to say that that's a test print, or it's that. My thinking as an AP is. These days is, it's what the artist keeps. So it should be the same, but it's what the artist keeps. So it should have be the same quality.
It should be conceived in the original edition as being the however many that are outside the edition, but acknowledged and documented and not ever increasing.
Yeah.
I mean, when you buy an edition, I think it's a golden rule to make sure the edition is closed and designated, and you are buying one of X plus however many APs, and that is a position which is monitored by. This actually gets back to Instagram buying. Photographs are perfectly formed to be sold online via a photographically visual medium because they're replicated perfectly. But good artists always have good galleries, and good photographic artists have good galleries that maintain their records and police their output and police the editions. Buying online or buying, you know, you take what you get, and you don't know what you're dealing with unless you are dealing with reputable galleries in the instance of buying online.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, Instagram is also, you know, you could look at Instagram as being kind of like television selling as well. I mean, it's the same principle. If you're going to buy anything from a, I think they always
don't have the aura of the multiple.
While we're on the subject of reputable galleries, can you recommend a few in Sydney or around Australia where we could look?
Well, there's the Commercial Galleries Association, isn't there?
The Australian Commercial Galleries Association have a website that has them listed. If you're quick, Stills Gallery will be open until June this year. If you're particularly looking for photography, they were one of the biggest ones here in Sydney, so it's a sad, sad demise for the industry to see them go.
And Art Month is on at the moment,
yes.
And so that's a good way of going around the galleries. There's tours and all sorts of stuff going on, and I'm sure they've got a comprehensive website. So you can look them up and go on one of their tours or, you know, and start looking, comparing different places.
Not to mention ACP and Photophile magazine.
Yes.
The other benefit is a lot of photographers have their own websites as well. So you can often come to, we do a curated program. We've got our curator Claire sitting up the back. And you can go to a curated program, and if you spot something on the wall that you like, you can always go and do more research into that artist and find out who they're represented by, whether they've got... Some artists have a gallerist in Melbourne that's different to the one in Sydney. They might have another one again in New York or Berlin, for example. So depending on where you are in the world and where you've seen the show, you might find a connection that way.
And usually that's documented on the in curated shows, it's documented which galleries the work's from. And also when works are imaged in magazines, it's usually indicated.
I have a question. It could be for either Judy or Amanda. A couple of years ago, I read this guy online was giving advice to people if they wanted to become a photography collector. And his really strict advice was, oh, you've got to specialise in something. You've got to collect, you know, photos of steam trains or American photography of the 1930s. And actually, I could kind of see the sense of it, but also to me, it sounded like it was becoming really boring. You know, that you almost had to work within a framework. I mean, do you guys have a view on that? Just buy whatever you like with no theme, or you've actually got to set parameters?
Look, I was talking about niches before, because it's one way, you know, some people look at the broad field of photography and go, oh my God, where do I start? I want to start somewhere, but I don't know where to start. So grouping, you know, having a focus is a good idea. But it isn't there's no right way, if you like. You know, there are no rules. It's, you need to, I mean, to just say that you have to do it like that is absurd. Because what benefit is that to someone who wants to collect, to think that they can only collect in a certain kind of way?
I suppose that given that most of the great works of art in the world are available to look at for nothing in museums, I suppose some people see the impetus of collecting. There are a number of impetuses. If you're going to buy something and have it in your own possession, there are a number of reasons. It's either economic, so that you can buy and sell it, or it's personal engagement, so you can acquire it, have it, it changes your life, you can add to it or subtract to it and actually have an impact on that object and other objects that are in its, whatever you put with it, so you have an impact on the field. And so if you collect one artist in depth, or if you collect one specific area in depth, you have a better chance of making an impact on that area via the way you have done it than if you have a scattergun approach. But as I said before, if you have a more disparate approach, then the way of connecting that disparate approach is buying things that actually tell a story about you, not necessarily the story about the object, so that they're all different and perfectly valid ways of collecting.
So if I could ask about your own collection, I mean, if somebody, would you say, oh, it has a theme, or it is just stuff that I love?
I would. My collection does have a theme, but it's a broad theme, only in terms that I'm interested in socially engaged photographs that have some kind of element of social engagement and tell a story about the time they're in and the situation, and hopefully have underlying resonances with politics or philosophy or but ultimately the collections that have moved me most, because I'm not that interested in steam trains, are collections that tell a story about the collector. And I would hope that talking about the steam train thing, you know, it gets back to my point about the collection has to speak to you for a long time as well as for you. And ultimately I would hope that my collection did say something about me, rather than just the objects that I'd collected. And I think you'd say the same thing, Judy, about your collection.
Well, I've probably got a bigger book collection than anything else, but yes, I guess it's true. Somehow or the other, it's probably hard for me to kind of distance myself from it, but because it's just sort of little bits and pieces that I've accumulated without it really being a collection as such.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Just a recommendation for research. There's a BBC in the British Broadcasting Corporation did a series called The Genius of Photography. It's two DVDs, six parts, and it covers everything from forgeries to auction houses to photographers talking about the work, why they do the work to collect this, etc. So if you can locate it anywhere, it's about $40 for two DVDs, The Genius of Photography by BBC. So
definitely.
Good start.
No more questions from anyone tonight? No? Okay. So thank you very much to you all for coming along, and a big thank you from the Australian Centre for Photography to our panellists, Amanda Love and Judy Annear. Just to let you know, we have a new exhibition of the work of Sean Gladwell, The Virtual Imperator, opening at our new project space at 72 Oxford Street next week. That opens to the public on Friday. And our workshops, of course, continue at the National Art School, and you can book in for those on our website. But thank you very much to Judy and Amanda.
Thank you.